Hi, everybody. Today, we're not going to talk too much about deep learning, but here's how I'm going to try and sell you on what we're going to talk about. Who wants more access to good, clean data? Hands up. Awesome. Okay, that's how we're going to sell you. Downside, there's going to be some work involved, so it's not scot-free, but we'll see how this goes. So yeah, hi, I get a clicker too. Oh, this is so professional. Hi, my name's Brendan. I work at QRI. We spell it QRI.io. And tonight we're gonna ask the question, where's the data bazaar? I think the best place to start with this is at the beginning. Now the big question is, what is the beginning? First off, what is software? Okay, this is a little existential. We won't stay here long. But for the purpose of this discussion tonight, I'm going to say that software is a tool for managing state. And it's worth sort of just like starting there in the beginning. And I was like looking at this wall of stickers, and it's like you can kind of go through every one of these startups. Like SoundCloud is a tool for managing the state of MP3s and playing that back for you. BuzzFeed is a tool for managing which like Harry Potter house am I in. You know, all of these have some sort of state management system going on. And why I think that's relevant is like we can sort of fast forward really quick to like, okay, what is the web made out of? Again, it seems like a disjointed question, but we'll connect the dots in a bit. The web is made of documents, HTML documents. And this, I think this is one of the most fun things to like remember all the time, that like at the end of the day, we are still all just sending around billions and billions of HTML files as like the thing that is our principal thing for rendering. And that's been the same for a long, long time. Lots and lots and lots and lots of HTML documents. And so like, to sort of get to this, to connect these dots about like, okay, we write tools that manage state, and let's look at like sort of how that got better over time on the internet. And so a history of the internet in 5 slides. All right, so this is sort of how the internet started. I've recently been reading through the white papers on DNS, which my favorite was there is actually a file called host.txt before DNS came in, and that you had to wait for that to get updated, and that's how your name got listed on the internet, and so you were like emailing somebody and they're FTPing. So like quite literally, the internet starts as servers serving HTML, and then we're like, okay, that needs to get better, so we're gonna enhance, and immediately we put in a database. And this pattern has been around for a while, right? This was before the internet. We had like IBM's information management systems, and like as we sort of work on software, there's always this sort of pattern that you see emerging time and time again, is the best way to deal with state is to manage it, to put it in a place where you can know what is the canonical store of truth, isolate it, put a box around it, and move it somewhere where you can make a predictable sort of assertions about it, right? So let's enhance some more, and this is sort of closer to what a modern web stack looks like now, right? We've got something like Nginx in the front, and then we add these like sort of application servers, and now we have a database, and then a backup replica of the database. And this is sort of like, again, just like, the thing to kind of note here is this gets more complicated over time, but what's going on, right? I love diagrams that draw the internet as a cloud. I'm assuming this is where we now have the cloud buzzword, but as the internet develops, data is moving away from those HTML documents, right? We have this sort of like system of abstractions. We're trying to sort of upgrade what HTML can do, and so we're inserting templating stuff, and we're inserting, we're sort of pushing data into more and more manageable places to do more and more interesting things. But the directionality of this sort of starts to get to some of the questions. This is sort of, has this implication, right? As we're trying to manage state, we are actually, if we flip that and look at it from a different direction, this is actually kind of a data silo, right? We're putting data in a place where it is predictable, but we're also moving it farther and farther away from some place where anybody could get at it, sort of in the raw, which is kind of the point, right? It's a really good pattern for building predictable software. But if we're gonna talk about where's the data bazaar, and this is where we sort of like have to posit some new worlds, right? And now that we've had the internet for a long time, and now that we're sort of able to do, we're starting to decade or so, we're really starting to realize the value of data intrinsically, right? Outside of software. I'm in a machine learning talk, like we're using data to program now, and that's a very interesting new concept that it is only possible because we have so much organized information, right? But if we're talking about a data bazaar, and we're talking about this goal of being able to get more structured information into the hands of more people, we have to sort of reimagine how we do sort of data composition. And so what I want to ask is, what does it look like to go and have the data go into that cloud thing instead of away from the cloud thing. And that's what we sort of call the data bazaar, right? In software, we sort of have two models for working that have emerged over time. We have this sort of cathedral model, which is a set of teams, a team that knows each other sort of, usually it's like small, working on a closed source project often. That's not always closed, but the people who are willing to accept sort of changes are all known. And then we have the open source sort of bazaar style model where I'll accept a pull request or I will accept a change from anybody on the planet so long as it's a good change, right? And so that's what we mean by a data bazaar. Is a data bazaar, in theory, would be a place where we can sort of audit and collaborate on each other's work as we see fit. And so how do we get there? I think when people sort of show up at this like data bazaar, you sort of like think of this thing, like let's just make the internet into one giant database. We spent a long time, my first crack at this problem was like this, basically, like let's just make the internet into a giant database. I think the words semantic web need to come up in here at some point, and this would be my slide for semantic web. And maybe let's not do that. And so what we're left with, if we're still playing with documents, databases, and applications, is like we start to get into weird land, right? Where we're going to try and combine things that didn't usually get combined. And so that's kind of what we're doing with QRI. QRI is an open source project, GPL licensed, aggressively open source project that is doing a couple of things. It's a new thing, but it's a new thing made of old stuff. We see QRI as a combination of three things at the same time. On one hand, it's a version control system. It looks a lot like Git, takes deep inspiration from Git. It's snapshot-based. Everything that it's versioning is immutable. On another hand, it's kind of like a database. It gives you capacity and tools to sort of access the data, filter the data, however you see a need fit. And then the third one, the sort of most harebrained animal in the room is a peer-to-peer network. We're sort of building QRI up at any given point, you can connect QRI to a distributed network and distribute that data for free to anybody by moving directly from your machine to theirs. But we think that this is too complicated for a day-to-day basis. What we actually sort of try to focus on is just having this mental model of just thinking about data sets. And we have a very specific definition of what we mean when we say data set, which we can get into. But everything in QRI is working with a data set as your conceptual hook. And so you are storing data sets, you're versioning data sets, you're sharing data sets with each other. It's just data sets all the way down. And so our sort of like weirdo hybrid database HTML document model is a data set. Data sets are broken up into six components for us. The one that is worth sort of starting with is actually in the bottom left. We call the body, which is sort of, again, riffing on this HTML document. The body is the actual content of the data set. So if you imagine, the easiest way to think about this is just a CSV file. Your CSV file is your body. And then the rest of these sort of complement and augment the body with capabilities and things that we need. I'll actually show you this when we get down to it. But what it sort of looks like in practice is we have these like lovely blobs which represent peers in a network, building up these data sets, and they are, every data set is sort of universal. So QRI is built on top of IPFS, which means that you have this really nice primitive of immutability and universal transmissibility to sort of move data sets around. Each data set is broken into blocks, and so moving it is, all of those blocks are registered onto a swarm, and so you can move lots and lots of stuff in parallel. Again, completely for free because you're just moving stuff from your computer to someone else's computer. So, with that, we're going to see how this goes. This is my first crack at like screen capping myself so that I can talk while a video plays. So I'm just going to show you what it looks like to work with QRI. I thought it'd be more fun to sort of show you the command line side of things, mainly because this is a more command line oriented audience. But today we're going to build a data set of something fairly basic, just the population of the world. This is an open data set. Thankfully, it is CC share alike by licensed, so we are totally allowed to do this, which is good. It's always good to check the licensing on the data. But we're going to build a data set up that creates a versioned archive of this, and we're going to sort of uncover how that works along the way. So, cool, terminal. Now, if I push this button, yes. Okay, so first thing, QRI version. All right, it works. All right, now I'm just going to type QRI, and this is the command line tool. I should note that this is going to move pretty fast. We'll post a tutorial later, but The first thing that, or we have posted a tutorial that I can link you to. The first thing I'm gonna do is just gonna set up query. This is literally fresh install out of the box, and I'm gonna name myself Captain Obvi, which was a great name in hindsight. And that's it. So that was the setup process. And what that's done under the hood is that's provisioned a repository that set me up so that my local hard drive now has this sort of space to put immutable stuff into. Cool. Step two. I now have a file, worldbankpopulation.csv, that I downloaded from that site. Oh yeah, I have to hit it again. Cool, ls, there it is. And the first thing we do is actually just save that file. And so we're gonna make the body of this data set, that CSV file, and I'm gonna give it a name. So this me World Bank population is a way of referring to that data set from here on in. And I got this long string of numbers and letters that is its hash on IPFS, and I got a version history. Cool. Next thing I'm gonna do is actually just run query connect, which puts me on the distributed web, and I'm gonna highlight where my sort of web app is, just so we can look at this on the front end. And so by visiting the local web app, it spins up our thing so we can now see our new data set. I click in, here it is, yay, check it out, look, stuff. And I think they're just like scrolling around. This is the actual body, so this is the data itself. And then we've got some of those other components we mentioned before. This is just a basic baseline visualization of it. This is the history of the data set itself. Did he click the structure? He, myself, in the past. I didn't click the structure tab. Cool. Structure would have shown the actual query under the hood, sort of inferred a schema and generated everything you need to interpret the data. Cool. Step two. This is great and all, but it's as it is, it doesn't have much in the way of metadata. And so in this case, we're just going to use the front end to edit the metadata itself. So I'm going to hit edit on this data set. You can edit any data set, including those you don't own. And then this is where I sort of like said, OK, cool, we should like actually show you how I got to this place. So I just popped into a search engine, World Bank Population. Cool, click the first link. And then actually just selected this stuff to actually pull in some of this metadata. And again, because we're sort of positioning this more for sharing, I'm making sure that I actually sort of give you something to work with in terms of, okay, what is this data set? How could I use it? When we were making query, we really focused on making this a little more straightforward. This metadata specification is intentionally interoperable with as many things as possible. So schema.org, dcat, which is a data catalog specification, and JSON-LD are all things that you can export to out of the box, which means that if you get this up on the internet, we can just make this show up in something like Google Dataset Search without any work from your on your end. So yeah, I'm going to add in a couple of other things that I think are sort of worth adding on a first pass, just like population, world, and bank. That was very original for tag names, but cool. And now we have our metadata. Great. And then that's not the end of this? Yes. Scrolling, whatever. Oh, yes. And we have two commits. Cool. And so if we ever need to, we can sort of diff these two things and see exactly what showed up. Query has inside of it a structural differ. And as you can see, our sort of our baseline visualization template has updated with our new metadata. Cool. Now, updating data is annoying, and so what we've done is we've embedded a transformation syntax into query so that a script to update the data set can travel with the data set itself. We're using Starlark, which is an open source project from Google, originally from its Bazel build system. The upside is it looks a lot like Python. Through the magic of copy and paste, we're just going to copy and paste in the really long script that I wrote beforehand that does exactly what we were doing before, just automating it. So we have query has two special functions that you can call, one called download and one called transform below. But all this is doing is going to that website. It's using a couple of other packages to like open a zip file, grab the thing, and save it, and then do whatever cleanup it needs to sort of produce a nice, clean CSV file. And so in this case, I'm just going to run query save again. But instead of providing a body, I'm just going to give it this transform.star file. And I'm going to hit save, and as I hit save, this is just going to write a new version, so I don't need to worry about losing any history here. And so we see query actually detected that that was a Starlark script, downloaded it, ran it, and gave me a new version of that data set. And the new version of that data set now includes that file with it, which we've in talking to a lot of people who work with data on a regular basis, it's really nice to have data the file that updates a data set tied to the data set itself. And so in this case, I think I mistakenly needed to reload this page. Hopefully I did, so I can drink some water while that happens. Yeah, there's that mistake. Cool. yeah, but the sort of important point to note here is that by embedding that transform script, I have now also added a piece of audibility to that, right? We've now, by tying these two pieces together, this ups the chances that you, someone who has never met the person who made this data set, can actually look at it, examine it, and determine whether this is something you want to work with or not. And so again, this is sort of pushing us into that internet cloud. Last thing I'm going to add is I'm going to update that templated script, sort of make it a little bit nicer. And so this is just using like very regular templating tags. And again, I'm going to do the exact same process as I did before in the transform script. I get plain old HTML. Query takes that plain old HTML document. I'm going to save it. And this is going to replace that stock visualization script that we had before. And so again, I'm just going to run query save, and the exact same idea. I'm going to type file, and I'm going to give it the name of this HTML file. It's really fun to watch a video of yourself making typing errors. So again, I'm just going to run connect and show you that really quickly. But I think something interesting will show up here when we actually reload this data set. And I think this is sort of the crux of the whole conversation. While we were working on that data, it was sort of, okay, cool, let's get the visualization up and running. This whole time I've just been sort of like getting data into a place where I can sort of look at it. Click this viz, it's like, great, yes, we have a graph, that's so fun. And then, wait a second, the population here is 79 billion? That's not the population of the world, right? And so I'm pretty sure that we downloaded everything properly, so now we finally like do the thing we should have done in the first place, which is our homework on this data. And you start scrolling through, and this is real. This actually happened while I was building this data set. The World Bank includes countries that are not physical regions in its listing of population. So that is there's something in the Baltics. There's going to be another one in a second. The Euro area. And so this really throws off the count. And so like now I'm kind of forced to make an interpretive approach, or I'm forced to make some interpretation of this data set to make it actually report the population, right? And this is where having a version history really makes a lot of sense. So in this case, I'm just gonna run query connect in another tab because I'm tired of showing you that same thing over and over again. But in this case, I now need to sort of make a better interpretation of this. I'm gonna go to query to get a data set that I can use to get a data set of country codes, and I'm gonna add that to my node. So now I just grabbed this data set from this person named B5, and it's now on my local machine. And so I can start to inspect it. It's like, cool, our default output is YAML, and it's not syntax highlighted, which I don't love, so I'm gonna do the default format as JSON. And that's not syntax highlighted, so I'm like, all right, let's pipe that to JQ. That's a lot better, all right. So now I can see this, okay, I can start my vetting and auditing process. I've grabbed this country code data set. Nice, all right, let's see what its transform script looks like, if it has one. In this case, I have to type, come on. Cool, there's a transform script. That looks pretty straightforward. If I need to, I can go to that website and start looking at this. And I did go to that website in that case. But I now have, if I reload this page, I now have this other data set that I have audited and I have taken a look at and I can now rely on. And so I go into this comprehensive country codes. Again, I'm just gonna show you this from the front end, but cool, it's got a really big schema. This is quite useful. Looking at the body, this is the thing that I want. I actually want the set of three-letter country codes, which the World Bank uses. Come on, there it is, cool. So these are the things that I need. Neat, all right, so now what I'm gonna do is, that's the end of that video, cool. Now I'm going to depend on that data set. And so we have data sets that can rely on other data sets, so I'm gonna load that data set just like any other import dependency, and query will track that for me. And because every data set is versioned, if the version of this country code data set ever changes, we're aware of the fact that this downstream data set needs an update. And so by combining versioning into this data set model, we have everything we need to sort of interpret everything as is. So now when I run query save, it is going to show that dependency and load it and keep the record of the exact hash that I ran this at. And so now we're going to produce everything. And what we'll do is that transform script uses that to filter out the data sets that are not actual countries. I should have timed this better. I have a little bit of dead space here, but yeah, cool. Also, we validate stuff. You can supply a JSON schema, which is an off the table, which is a standard spec for the open API specification, and use that to validate your data. You can also throw your data into strict mode. We haven't shipped that yet. Oh, we will. So yay, now we have the proper population. That's great. And most importantly, we have a history of changes. Something that I'm not demoing here tonight is we can actually do diffs between all of these, and we can show you exactly what elements changed, including on the body. We had to develop a linear time structured data differ, which took us a little while, but it exists, so cool. All right, and then two last things. Now that we have this World Bank population, we should point out to the fact that this is distributed immutable data. So I can actually go to some website that I don't own and hit this, and this is what you'll actually see if you go to that on the distributed web right now. So this hash, I can also go to the dataset.json. Everything we've been doing is stored in IPFS and completely independent of query. And so all of this body CSV data, this is all out there sort of stored in a nice encapsulated thing that is versioned, but also sort of is just a combination of CSV files and JSON files and an HTML file. So the thing that we're boiling down to is all just standard off-the-shelf technology. And we think that that's really important. So now we have a method for distributing stuff around for free, for versioning stuff however we want, for creating graph dependencies of those versions, and for shipping around these default visualizations that we need to sort of like make that data set interpretable and usable. And so we think that's kind of a fun combination. Last but not least, one of the problems that you run into with the distributed web is keeping data available, right? Keeping my laptop on is a bit of a challenge. So if I run query publish, we run a cloud service that runs a bunch of IPFS nodes in the cloud. So now I've done an rsync-like process where I've now pinned that data set to a permanently available thing. Because this is public data, we will totally accept it. And so we will take that data and we'll host that for you. And so now that data set is available to anybody who needs it. So when I ran query search in the first place and grabbed that country codes thing, it was there. And it came from, in that case, it came from our, we call it the registry of stuff. So is that it? What else is going on? Oh, this shouldn't be here. Oh, yes. And then finally, last but not least, you can update data, which is just rerunning the script, right? And so that means go recheck that World Bank set. If anything changed between now and then, we would actually find out, oh, cool. And it's one of the best sort of messages to get error, no changes detected, where you know that, oh, cool, we reran the script and we got no different results, which is sort of a nice thing. So anyways, yeah, this is applying to sort of like pulling data from an external source, but you can see how there's a number of workflows that pop up from this, right? If you're just working with data sets and you want to be able to version that internally, there's nothing that stops you from creating an internal version, versioning those changes over time and using query to just compare the changes and move them between peers. Because everything is immutable, writing down the hash of the data set that you're using is exactly recording the version that you input to, say, your model at any given point in time. So yeah, this is obviously like a big, ambitious project in the sense that it is heavily reliant on all of us sort of doing some of this together. We make a lot of technology, but this is very much an open collaborative project. We're hoping to facilitate a big shift in the way we think about collaborating on data. If we use tools like this and work with each other to bring down the amount of time we spend munging data, we think it'll be a lot easier. I didn't push that button, but cool. So obviously, this is the end of my talk. But yeah, we're really hoping that if you have the time, if you have a data set that you use a lot or a process you apply a lot to a data set, it'd be really worth sort of giving it a shot at putting it on query. And if you have any questions whatsoever, we're an open source project, and we're on that. And if you make issues, we will fix them. And yeah, I think that's kind of it. Thank you. Yeah, anybody have any questions?
There's always questions.
Oh, I did great. You have no questions at all.
Here we go.
I love it when I perfectly explain things. It goes so well.
How we are going to use this in enterprise? I mean, is that something which using over the intranet, so we don't want the data to go outside?
Absolutely.
Firewall?
Yeah. So you can spin up private peer-to-peer networks. And so you can have a peer-to-peer network where only people with the fingerprint of that network are able to participate, which is fun for like on-premise stuff. The nice thing is like query, the company never needs to see any of your data. We can just help administer the bootstrap nodes of a network if needed. The other side of this, and this is sort of an in-progress thing, we're hoping to do sort of encryption at rest and the other side of private data, which is we start intentionally with public. We want to get this right. We want to get all the systems for versioning in place correctly. But obviously, private data is something that we have to cross. So we've been working on the specification for that for a little while. A lot of it involves, we have to do a lot of work around key rotation and access control involving key rotation. So there's a lot of GAC there. But
also integration with other industrial size database as well. Is that possible?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
Ingesting this data to other databases, conventional databases.
Absolutely. Yeah, and so the query is very much about interop. We store in sort of like regular formats, but you know, we're working hard on an Apache Arrow integration to just directly pipe data to Plasma. Same thing with like a lot of the other sort of common tools you'd want. Just being able to pipe query data to SQL, to a Hadoop cluster, whatever you want, into a Kafka queue, knock yourself out. The whole thing under the hood is built as a streaming set of interfaces, and so you should be able to just pipe in and out to stuff.
Cool, great concept. Thank you.
That was my question, by the way.
Everyone asks about the private thing. It's like, yeah, Eventually, we'll get it.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, I guess I gotta turn the camera on myself. Here, would you point at me? How does this work with media?
Absolutely, with like, yeah. And this, I'm glad that someone asked the like image conversation. With media, right now we focus purely on structured data. Again, just because we wanted to get, it's a bit of a heavy lift to get the first bit. We have every intention of actually embedding whatever you want into the DAG that is actually produced, the data set that is produced. And so we call that arbitrary inclusion. So you can link to whatever you want. That could be images, that could be video. It's obviously gonna inflate the size of what you're moving around and versioning. But all of these versioning tools really help because we're calculating hashes at the file level. So adding the same JPEG image at once that sort of tech is in place, if you change version to version, you're not adding any new data to your underlying block store. So that's the hope. It's going to take us a little while.
Hold on a sec.
All right. My question is, how exactly do you handle, for instance, one of the elements of the data set may be links to another table?
Mm-hmm.
How would you handle that?
Absolutely. Yeah. So the link data side of this is an ongoing conversation. As we saw that we sort of mapped a dependency between data sets in the Starlark transform script. But as it comes from like linking tables together, I think is that sort of the general gist you're getting at. Generally, we can sort of resolve any IPFS hash or anything under the hood as we need. So we can sort of build in that as necessary. Checking for that resolution or checking for something that we need to resolve would need to be specified by you. So you'd have to be saying, cool, I have a schema and all of this column or element in a high dimensional object is a link to something. And then we can sort of start the resolution process. Hopefully, is that helpful?
I have two questions.
Mm-hmm.
One, can you give like a couple of use cases where this is being used or this can potentially be used? And the other one is, are there REST API calls for the web interface that you have so that we can pull the data?
Absolutely.
If there is anything that is changed, we can possibly trigger some other processes.
Webhooks.
Like webhooks. Like,
yes.
Yeah. As soon as you were like in midway through that question, I was like, oh, that would be awesome. We should totally do that. So we don't have webhooks. We do have a JSON API. Everything I showed you with the front-end web app is talking over JSON API. We've documented it. We need to get that documentation on our website. In terms of use cases, the use cases we're seeing a lot right now are a lot in the open data space. And so we have a lot of people in the... we've been using it a lot for archiving. Initially, this project was actually born out of trying to build an archive, a distributed archive of the EPA, or the EPA's data. And so that process of continually checking against a canonical source for changes is a really important side of this. The other place we're seeing is like just data collaboration, being able to take two people who have different opinions of a data set, compare those versions. That's obviously the one that we're very excited about long term. So webhooks totally will do it. JSON API, yes.
I have a question. How do you integrate with Pachyderm? Have you heard of it?
Absolutely, we've heard of Pachyderm. I think Pachyderm's delightful. I think Pachyderm is a better solution if you're looking for container-based work where you really want to repeat at the machine level what's going on. I looked at containers very early in this project and decided that containerization is just too heavy a burden for doing this kind of data set management. And so we focused on putting everything we could into one binary that can operate on a Raspberry Pi. And that's where we sort of differ from Pachyderm. I think it's a great tool if you really need to say, hey, I want this OS, I want everything that containerization brings. So we don't really integrate with it. You could totally run query inside of Pachyderm. I don't know why you would, but it's possible. Does that help?
Okay, so let's assume that this is wildly successful and you have lots and lots of data sets being shared.
Mm-hmm.
I have a couple of questions about that. So first, you showed an example where you went and found a data set with country codes in it, right?
Mm-hmm.
How would one go about discovering data, right? So assuming there's lots and lots of data sets, in fact, there may in fact be multiple data sets that overlap with one another.
Absolutely.
Maybe 1,800 people share their own private country code lists. How would you discover the data and find what's probably the best canonical source of it?
Absolutely.
And this sort of the second question on the same topic is, what happens when people share data that they don't own and isn't free, and it propagates over a peer-to-peer network?
Absolutely. Oh, two great, that was a nice like double whammy of like, when you're super successful, oh, I'll answer that question. And then like, oh, when everything goes wrong, oh, I don't want to answer that question. when we're wildly popular, sure. We have some really nice properties here, and we've really focused on that eventuality. If you calculate, if two people are doing the same thing, the hash of the body will resolve to the same set of blocks. And so we can actually see, oh, look, you are talking about literally the same data. And that's a string comparison. So it's a very fast conversation for us to have. So building a conversation not just about the commonalities of the data is very easy, but also the commonalities of use, right? So you're seeing people depending on data sets. We can walk that graph backwards and say, this data is more popular. That doesn't mean it's better, but it does mean that more people are using it, which really helps sort of at scale. We think that that aspect of things is really nice. In terms of dealing with volume of data, do you want me to answer that at all? Yeah, sure. For volume, like we have this sort of, we've intentionally spent a lot of time making sure that the things that move with different frequencies of time, for example, metadata changes at a different sort of periodicity than a body does often, those are all versioned separately. And so that's sort of like taking a bunch of time under the hood to sort of make sure that works properly. It also means that you sort of have, you will eventually introduce new tools that are sort of less Git-like and more sort of data management-like, oriented toward the dataset size stuff, being able to sort of compress or drop specific bodies that you don't think are no longer necessary, but keep the hashes as an audit trail. So that's part of it. How do we deal with the, oh no, you just put a whole bunch of person identifiable information into a peer-to-peer network problem? This is where we sort of break a little bit from the purists on the distributed side, and we actually run something called a registry. And that registry is how we do unique peer names. It's also how we sort of enforce a policy on the network. We have made that optional, so you can opt out of the registry and go fully distributed. We call that hard mode, and we don't help you do it. But the upside of running something with a registry means that if we can actually introduce the notion of a reputation. So if somebody releases data, whether maliciously or otherwise, we can sort of drop you for 24 hours and say, okay, no peer should connect to you for the next little while, just because you're propagating data that's probably not the best to propagate. We can also sort of mark that hash as something that shouldn't be sent around too much. Because the data is immutable, it's a little easier to sort of say, nope.
This is how I get my work out.
Yeah.
Does Europe's GDPR law affect you? And if so, how?
I wish I was a lawyer. We're mainly dealing in open data intentionally. I don't have a good answer to your question. I'm not boned up enough on Europe's GDPR laws. We have a GDPR policy, privacy policy for anything that you submit to us on our server-side stuff. But the amount of server-side data we keep is your public key pair hashed and your username. And so like it's a pretty basic set of things. You can query our API for literally everything that you have. So our GDPR compliance is a little bit strict.
I can help you with that.
Awesome. Amazing. Thank you so much for your patience, everybody. This is
maybe rephrasing his question. Is there a place to do like an authorization policy call within the architecture?
In the architecture of the stack right now, no. Should be. Short answer. Yeah. We need to introduce that, which sounds like I have a conversation to have immediately after this. Cool. Does that help?
Lots of questions.
Yeah.
Can I reference the data sets canonically? For example, if I want to cite it in a paper or something like that, can I reference particular datums within one of the data sets?
Specific data items within a data set?
Yes.
Absolutely. So you can combine a JSON pointer with IPFS pathing to get down into specific elements of a data set and reference it exactly down to, cool, row 20, column, whatever, object, key, go all the way in. And you would be able to reference a specific piece of data. You can also add at any version at any given point. Thank you for the wonderfully great question that I can just like answer. You can do that. It's awesome. You can't do that on the regular internet, which is why we built it on the distributed internet. But yeah, cool. Is that helpful? I think that's probably plenty, right? You've all stared at me enough. Cool.
Are we good? No more questions? Okay, in that case, why don't we give Brendan a hand?